Hachette Audio presents Persians, the Age of the Great Kings, written and read by Lloyd Llewellyn-Jones. A bowl of wine is the mirror of Alexander. Look, it displays the state of King Darius' realm to us. Hafez. To my students, past and present, for joining me on the journey back to Persia. Prologue. Persepolis, 488 BCE. If now you should think, how many are the countries which King Darius held? Look at the sculptures of those who bear the throne. Then shall you know. Then shall it become known to you. The spear of the Persian man has gone forth far. Then shall it become known to you, the Persian man has delivered battle far indeed from Persia. Inscription from the tomb facade of Darius the Great. At the Nowruz festival in the spring of 488 BCE, the time in which the Persians celebrated their new year with feasting, partying, and gift-giving, Darius, great king, king of kings, king of all lands, the Achaemenid, sat on his throne in the heart of his palace city of Persepolis and magnanimously received the homage of his empire. Huge bronze trumpets ripped the air with triumphant fanfares, and an orchestra of drums, cymbals, and sistra, accompanied by harps and lyres, created a rhythmic march which heralded the commencement of the glittering ceremonies that were central to the joyful festival. Foreign diplomats had travelled from far and wide to Persepolis in order to bring Darius their tribute. From Libya they came, from Pakistan, from the southern Eurasian steppe, Egypt, Asia Minor, Mesopotamia, Syria and India. They came carrying gold, turquoise, lapis lazuli, wool tapestries, silk coats, cotton tunics and spices, and leading horses, camels, sheep, and even lions into the lofty throne room. They prostrated themselves on the floor in abject humility in front of the great king, grasped the hem of his robe, and loyally kissed his feet. Darius the Great took enormous satisfaction in surveying his empire in this way, as ambassadors and diplomats paraded before him, one delegation following another in strict formation, displaying the bounty of so many far-off lands. He must have smiled at his success, for he was indeed a mighty king, the unrivaled ruler of the seven climes. The evidence of his prowess was right there, marching before his eyes. So what if squalid little Greece had avoided capture and remained out of reach? There would be other opportunities to bring that wretched outpost of civilization under heel. Besides, proof of the success of his empire building was parading before him. And if evidence were needed of its good order and efficiency, Darius only had to observe the spectacular and very well-disciplined presentation ceremony in which his subject peoples so readily participated. For they were not humiliated slaves, thrust to the ground in oppression and trembling in terror before their overlord, but willing partners in a glorious imperial enterprise. They enthusiastically offered Darius their loyalty, their service, and their tribute. Or so he chose to believe. The diplomatic gift-giving ceremony was so intrinsic to his understanding of empire that Darius had it represented in painted stone reliefs on the staircases which led up to his massive throne hall at Persepolis, the so-called Apadana, at nearby Naqshirustam, on the facade of his rock-faced tomb, which he had commissioned in preparedness for the day when it would inevitably be needed. Darius had his artist sculpt a variation on the same theme. He was shown in the act of worshipping his divine protector, the god Ahura Mazda, standing on a throne platform, a taht, as it was known in Persian, which was raised high above the heads of representatives of the different peoples of the empire in a joyous act of reciprocal collaboration. It was a visual celebration of the diversity of Darius's empire. An inscription, carved into the rock in old Persian cuneiform lettering, invited the viewer to count the figures who represented the various geographical regions which made up the empire, each one clothed in national costume, to make the point clearer. To make sure that none were missed, the artist carefully labelled each of them. This is the Persian. This is the Mede. This is the Elamite. This is the Parthian. This is the Arian. This is the Bactrian. This is the Sogdian. This is the Chosamian. This is the Drangianian. This is the Achosian. This is the Satagidian. This is the Gandharan. This is the Indian. This is the drug-drinking Saka. This is the pointed hat Saka. This is the Babylonian. This is the Assyrian. This is the Arab. This is the Egyptian. This is the Armenian. This is the Cappadocian. This is the Sardian. This is the Ionian. This is the Scythian from across the sea. This is the Thracian. This is the sun hat wearing Ionian. This is the Libyan. This is the Nubian. This is the man from Mecca. This is the Carian. The royal rhetoric propounded on Darius's tomb emphasized the notion that all conquered nations were united in service to him, the great king, a warrior king, whose spear has gone forth far, whose laws they obeyed, and whose majesty they upheld. Darius the Great was thusly lauded not only as the great king and king of kings, but also king of countries containing all kinds of men, king of many countries, as well as king in this great earth far and wide. All subject peoples were put under Darius's rule, and he made it clear that he would tolerate no trouble or brook no resistance. What I said to them, he stated with gravitas, that they did, as was my desire. Yet, by projecting an image of harmonious cooperation, Darius propounded that his empire worked best when it pulled together and was unified in purpose. The empire functioned well when all the peoples he ruled bought into his notion of family. When they cooperated, they unequivocally benefited from the security of a Pax Persica, a Persian peace. In the Nowruz celebrations of 488 BCE, when the 62-year-old Darius sat upon his throne and received the ambassador's homage and accepted their much-valued gifts, he was accompanied by his son and chosen successor, Xerxes. This young man, good-looking, independently minded and pious, had already served in the empire's administration as a satrap or a regional governor in Parthia, where he had honed its skills as a bureaucrat, and there was nothing Darius admired more than a good record keeper, and as a judge. Aged 30, Xerxes was now back at court at his father's side and was functioning as the Achaemenid heir elect. He was not Darius's elder son, however, nor was he even a second son. No, for Darius had many sons who were much older than Xerxes. These men had been born to the numerous women of his harem. But Xerxes was the first boy born to Darius after he had ascended Persia's throne. And so it was fitting that the Achaemenid Empire should pass to him, the first royal baby born into the purple. Besides, through his esteemed and clever mother, Atossa, Xerxes carried the blood of Cyrus the Great in his veins. This alone qualified him, more than any of his brothers, for the kingship. Darius was confident that the Achaemenid line would flourish under Xerxes, whose own principal consort, Amastris, had already borne a brood of healthy boys, and who herself was to prove to be a contentious dynastic matriarch. In the spring of 488 BCE, the Achaemenid family's future was secure. Introduction. This is a history.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.